Can you tell in your own words what the troubles were? tell about, well, I'm sorry. Oh. I just don't, you know, I don't want to, you know, I want to keep
it started before I was born, right? You know, so I can't. What the troubles were is contested, like super contested. By me saying a narrative about what happened, there would be 20 other narratives that would all be like, no, that's bullshit, blah, blah, blah.
To go to bed every night and the helicopter would be overhead constantly. The searchlight would be scanning the ground. There would be very, very frequent bombs which shook the house and which shook the whole town.
So there's the peace wall. Still many peace lines, peace walls in Belfast that divide housing areas. The big peace wall here is between the Shankill Road and the Falls Road on the other side. And that's a picture and a very visible symbol of the division in the country.
So I moved here when I was 10. So I moved here in like whatever it was, 91 or something. When I first moved, I had a really strong London accent, which is like really bad when we moved to West Belfast. It's like, don't have a fucking English accent. It's the worst place you can move to. Even though we went to a Catholic school, if you're talking like a Brit. So I was about 10, from the age of 10 to 12. Sometimes we'd get bullied a wee bit and sometimes we would join in, like throwing bricks at the policemen.
You were, I'm sorry, I don't know, you were part of the
Catholic? I was, yeah, not anymore. And I went to a Catholic school, St. Louise's on the Falls Road, which was a famous school for all the fighting, because on the Falls Road, like that's where a lot of fights was.
In Belfast, in those days, like there used to be called a thing called the Ring of Steel. And it was basically like a massive big fence that was around the shopping district, right? And you had to get searched to go into it, right? And the bus used to go through it, my bus home used to go through it, and the army man used to get on with his like massive gun and walk up the aisle of the bus to check there was no bombs on the bus, you know? And that was just like what happened, you know? That was just like, yeah. And then I grew up a wee bit and I started to drive, and you realize that like you're driving, you get stopped and asked for your ID, you get army checkpoints all the time. And it's just kind of oppressive, but you don't realize it.
So I didn't know anything about the Troubles, and I was probably too young as well to fully understand the Troubles when we first moved here. We moved right beside one of the sort of areas of conflict, which is near the Royal Victoria Hospital, near the Falls Road. And we lived in Victoria Towers. So there were three towers. We were in the middle tower on the 10th floor, and on the 12th floor, the army stayed as well. So they would come in every now and then, and we'd see them hanging around the campus, and then they'd obviously be on the 12th floor because it's a really good lookout post.
Me and all my sisters went to an integrated primary school and an integrated secondary school, which basically means that it's like 50-50. So the school had to be half Protestant, half Catholic. And then I think there's like a 20% like non-denominational. Even to this day, apart from two integrated secondary schools, every secondary school in Northern Ireland is either Protestant or Catholic. It is defined by religion, which is just ridiculous.
There can almost be a street which is very safe, and the road just beside it, you wouldn't go near. I mean, that's the way the map of Belfast was whenever I was growing up. There were bridges that you couldn't cross. The answer really for the future is in the integrated education system, where at an early age, we're not learning those words. We're not seeing people of different persuasion as being different from us. And that is hardwired into the brain as a kid. It's very hard to lose that.
We almost didn't feel that involved as well because we weren't from here originally. So although the troubles were happening, we weren't necessarily in the middle of it. And also because we weren't Catholic or Protestant, we didn't really have a side. So whenever we arrived, it was like, okay, you're Hindu, but are you a Catholic Hindu or are you a Protestant Hindu? like, whatever that means.
In Belfast in the 70s, there was kind of like area ethnic cleansing, you know, like, so people got put out. If you were from one community or the other, you got put out, you know, you got your house burnt. All those kind of binary things happened then, and then we build walls between the two communities, and then everything becomes very kind of hardened.
Going back to Good Friday, 1998, we saw it as an opportunity for a beginning of hope. There was nothing in it for the people who had suffered loss through the 30 years before that. What I've come to learn is that actually it is in dealing with what we did to each other in this place. That's where the true reconciliation lies. There still is deep down in our community a sense that there maybe still is a difference between Protestant laws and Catholic laws. And therefore we politicize loss. And we politicize the atrocities, and we politicize the grief and the bereavement and the terror and horror. And we don't look at the human cost. Also, by stripping away any reference in my little bits of text beside each painting to Protestant, Catholic, UVF, IRA, RUC, whatever grouping it happened to be. And so we were forced to look at the human and we question ourselves. Of course, that's what I believe art is there to do. The magic that happens in the encounter where the person who engages with it brings something to it as well. And that's where the answer lies. The answer doesn't lie with the work of art. The answer can lie in a viewer discovering something or able to answer something for themselves as a result of engagement with art. Art should pose the question.
It's a difficult area to come into and do a new project, especially an arts project, because people are suspicious of anybody new coming in wanting to do something. The idea of doing a carnival parade was something they hadn't thought about or come across. All they knew about were parades that celebrate the history and celebrate the past, and celebrate battles that, you know, our side has won and the other side has lost. And while that's a part of our history and tradition, what I'm saying through the work that we do is that there's something else as well as that that we should be doing, which is looking forwards and looking to the future.
But sometimes I would not trust success a little bit because it's scary. And sometimes I would worry that the show A Belfast Prayer is touring because of the past of the war and because of Brexit at the moment and because of the situation in Northern Ireland. So it's quite a nice thing for people unaffected by that to have a look at it. I don't want to be selling trauma. I want to be releasing it. And if you're using subject matter about things that is politically important to you and is personally important to you, and you're trying to channel that in the now and also in the past and allowing joy and pain to come out at the same time, to me, it feels like it can be a clearing. Then you're doing choreography, but that's how I think it feels, a bit like a prayer, because you're trying to take shit and evaporate it.
Like the thing I can do best, which is produce artwork that like talks about feminist issues and about, you know, rights that people don't have. And if that's the best thing I have to offer right now to that cause, like, you know, that's what I'll do.
So the first project we actually did was the Another Belfast Map, which was showcasing independent places and spaces that were really interesting all over Belfast that weren't covered in the commercial maps. And then Design Week was the second project that came out of that community. And one of the key thoughts in that was that we wanted to make Belfast a design destination. So something like Copenhagen, where people go there for design and they buy design, and it really helps the local people, it helps the culture as well as the economy. A lot of people think that once they maybe study design, they have to go away to set up a business or work for a company, because there aren't that many fashion-led companies or interior companies here. But it'd be nice for people to realize they can stay here as well. So all of us that work on Design Week, we work on a voluntary basis to make it all happen. And I think a lot of people don't realize that, because people think, oh, it's a Design Week, so it's hugely funded, or it's like this big thing. But we do it outside of our main work. I guess the reason we do it is because we want there to be a reason for people to stay here and create a really nice design industry. We want to be able to ourselves also continue practicing here. And unless we put the energies into it, which we don't really see a lot of people doing, it's not going to happen. So we kind of feel that if we want this to happen, we have to try and make it happen ourselves.
Belfast is a really hard place to be an artist, for all the reasons that I've talked about, in terms of like an institutional lack of respect, primarily, you know, and an idea that you're a waster, a sponger, and that you're not contributing to society. You know, we don't like music and colour and movement and emotion because of tourism or economic development or health. We like them because we're human, right? Because we're people. And if we don't have fucking something to live for, then what's the point of, like, what's the point of being really healthy and having a job and being able to pay your bills if your life is grey and dull and shit? Like, you might as well just go home, right? And we don't understand that as a society. We don't get this idea that these people are really important. And that really pisses me off. Like, my passion in life is, you know, making space for the non-binary. In Belfast, non-binary is people who don't ascribe themselves as nationalists or unionists or Protestants or Catholics or loyalists or Republicans, and just actually want to get on and enjoy each other and enjoy life and get on with all the brilliant stuff that we have going on.
When we were in East Belfast, I wanted to do something there to create different pictures of East Belfast, because at the time, although it was ceasefire and peace, still the news had people being shot and just a lot of bad news, you know, loss of employment in the shipyard and so on. So we did a lantern parade, a nighttime carnival. And another reason for doing the nighttime event was that because it was about lanterns carrying light, which of course is a symbol of hope as well. I remember one of the parades in East, this is in East Belfast then, where people from the two opposite sides of the roads, which were Protestant, Catholic, Loyalist, Republican, came together to join in the parade, and people were hugging each other, and people were, it was just not usual. In the past, if we had seen people coming out from those houses, it meant there was going to be a fight, there was going to be a riot. And here we were actually joining together to do something that was about friendship and community. And but for me, the importance of the work that we're doing is just the public nature of it, the fact it's happening on the street and on streets that would be associated with trouble and violence and the history of the place. And we're actually bringing people out. Well, to use that phrase again, you know, to create a different picture of who we are as a neighbourhood and as a society and as individuals. Giving people additional senses of identity is a big part of what we can do through the arts work.
Now, the Brexit is happening.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Are you afraid that it will change for the worst? Or?
Yeah, I mean, I think we all are. I think the world is a better place whenever we unite rather than whenever we divide. And we are in the process of dividing. And I think that that ultimately is a bad thing.
So, are you optimistic?
Yeah, it's going to be good. Yeah.
Yeah,
for sure. It can't get any worse, can it?
Yes, it can.
No, I've there's loads of really good people I know who are working really hard, so it'll get better for sure. I don't think it'll be a war. Do you think it's going to get better in Israel?
I'm not naive enough to think that, like, I can change the world, but, you know, I'm interested in change. I'm interested in community and building shared spaces and finding ways that people from different backgrounds can coexist. I'm interested in promoting the advantages of the arts and creativity and critical thinking and all those things which seem to kind of be under fire. And if people don't stand up for those things and fight for those things, then we are fucked, like, to be frank. So you can bleep that out.